So, my name is Joana Setzer. I am a postdoctoral British Academy Fellow at the Grantham in Law. And before I introduce our speakers, I would like to take this opportunity to put this panel into context. For countries to combat climate change, litigation to reduce emissions and adapt to impacts has been known to be important. In the past decade, we have also been observing a groundswell of initiatives, climate actions from businesses, NGOs in the local and regional levels. What is less well known is the role of courts. So we ask ourselves, do courts play any role in addressing climate change? Well, on the one hand, we can think of litigation as something that will facilitate action. We can imagine then litigation making policymakers accountable, enforcing the rule of law, and therefore helping us to address this problem. But climate litigation, as most litigation, is what we call a type double-edged sword. It could also be used to, for example, question legislation which corporations might find too stringent. So we're interested in exploring these links between climate litigation and climate legislation. At the Grantham, we are now developing this project together with the Sabin Center for Climate Change at Columbia University. And what we're doing, we are bringing together our climate legislation database with their climate litigation database. So we're merging these two data sets together. And with this information, we are hoping to be able to understand better the dynamics between climate litigation and legislation. Some of the people involved in this project are here, Alina Cherkova and Mook Bangalore and Shorion. Some of them are here in this room today. And we, therefore, are very excited to understand better the roles of litigation. So this is just to explain where we came from in organizing this event. So this brings me to introduce our speakers tonight. It is my great pleasure and honor to introduce you to Gillian Lobo and Harry Osofsky. Gillian joined ClientEarth in 2015. And I don't know if you know ClientEarth, it's a very interesting organization. ClientEarth basically uses the law as a tool to address many of the problems that we face. Climate change, air pollution being one of them. You might have heard about climate change winning this high court case recently against the UK government, and many other very interesting cases that they are involved. Gillian is qualified as a solicitor. She holds a law degree from University of Sheffield and a master's from SOAS. Here on my right side is Professor Harry Osofsky. She arrived today from the US. We're very happy to have her with us. She's presenting today here and tomorrow at the Grantham. And Professor Harry Osofsky has a long and very impressive list of accomplishments and scholarship. She is going to join very soon Penn State Law University as a dean. And for the moment, she's still at University of Minnesota, where she is Robbins Kaplan Professor of Law, Faculty Director of Energy and Transition Lab, Director of the Joint Degree Program in Law, Adjunct Professor in the Department of Geography, and Fellow with the Institute of on the Environment. How do you do all of this? I don't know. She, on top of this, still has over 50 publications in journals and a number of books. One of them, it's our main reference on climate litigation, a book recently published with Jack Peel by Cambridge University Press. And therefore, we are sitting next to one of the most expert persons in this topic. So we're being chaired by Dr. Veerle Heyvaert, who is an associate professor here. And she teaches environmental law, European law, and also has a number of publications in transnational environmental law. And she'll be sharing this event tonight. So welcome everyone, thank you for your presence. This event is going to be recorded, so if you want to go back to it, it will be probably available on our website. Thank you.
And do not swear. Okay, we're going to start the evening having a presentation by Gillian, is going to present first. After that, if there are pure questions of clarification, then you can raise them right after Gillian's presentation. If not, then we move on straight to Harry's presentation and we will open up for discussion after that. Each panelist will present for approximately 20 minutes with a little bit of flexibility if needed. So we should have ample time for a very lively discussion. So I hope you all very much enjoy tonight's event. And with that, Gillian, I turn it to you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. The aim for me today is to give you a brief session where I'd like to consider climate change as a legal issue. So, sadly, we're in a time of great political and social uncertainty, and at such times the role of the judiciary becomes more critical as citizens turn to the courts to uphold their rights in the face of unlawful actions of governments. And recent examples we've had here is challenges in the court, our own challenge that went all the way up to the UK Supreme Court on the Article 50 decision, the legal challenges to Trump's executive orders on immigration, and generally the interest in the judiciary is much greater in terms of even the nomination of the ninth judge to the US Supreme Court, which I think he was being interviewed today. These all show, as I say, the important role we as lawyers and also the independent judiciary play in a democracy. So, looking at climate change generally, by way of background, the first wave of climate change litigation was conceived during the George Bush Jr. administration following his withdrawal from the Kyoto Protocol and his weakening of environmental procedures. These claims followed more traditional lines, such as the administrative challenge in Massachusetts against the EPA, a challenge against the EPA's denial of a petition to regulate the emissions of four greenhouse gases, including CO2, under the specific clean air legislation. Then there was also the more speculative and unsuccessful public nuisance claim against a number of fossil fuel companies in Kivalina and Exxon and others. During the Obama administration, we saw climate change evolve to become more constitutionally based challenges. Such claims also migrated to other jurisdictions, the most successful in Europe so far being the claim in agenda against the Dutch government's policy on greenhouse gas reductions. The decision, and this is oft repeated, is known as the groundbreaking agenda decision, in that the court, in this case, the Dutch ordered the Dutch state to limit the state's annual greenhouse gas emissions to 25% below the 1990 levels by 2020. So that's quite a strong judgment. The agenda arguments are now being exported to other jurisdictions. In addition to these high-profile claims, climate change is more generally relevant to all lawyers because it finds its way into our conventional legal practices. So even if you're in a corporate situation, you're going to be coming across climate change, and I'll talk about various other examples. So when considering climate change as a legal problem, we should note the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's warning that the effects of climate change, such as high temperature, sea level rise and increasing extreme weather events will cause widespread loss, damage and harm to human health, property, infrastructure and the economy over the course of this century. Climate change will therefore pose physical risks to assets and operations, including supply chains from extreme weather events, sea level rise and loss of natural capital. We have the transition risks to business and markets resulting from the transition to a low-carbon economy. Risks will arise from technological disruption, greater regulation, and changing consumer habits. then they're going to be liability risks. These are to companies and directors for failing to consider and manage the above risks, and to their insurers potentially. Also, these harms are recognised and accepted internationally. It is difficult, although these harms are recognised so widely, it is very difficult to fit climate change into the usual boxes required to bring a legal claim. And anyone who sort of looked at bringing a court action will know the sort of various elements that you have to establish. And some of the difficulties that we have are cumulative emissions since the Industrial Revolution, multiple emitters, scientific uncertainty, transboundary and diffuse impacts, the impacts are deferred and the onset slow, future adverse impacts projected to be very significant, economic impact of burning less fossil fuels and our general economic systems, vested interests, and social and political factors. Despite all this, litigation will arise. In the past, environmental law was primarily about enforcing environmental statutes. But with the onset of the impacts of climate change, both in physical and in financial terms, this widens the types of laws citizens can use. So how to try and make sense of all of this? How this is a huge array of potential causes of action. What laws do we use? Environmental laws, competition law, energy law, company, financial. Who are the claimants? Are they going to be citizens? Are they going to be pension funds, property owners, shareholders, regulators, insurers, and public interest law firms and NGOs like ClientEarth? Who are the defendants? You've got a whole range of those. States, companies, investors, carbon majors, local authorities. So potentially anyone can be a claimant, and anyone could be potentially a defendant also. So the breadth of the legal challenge is another issue. Legal challenges will range from the conventional to the more speculative and innovative. So more conventional claims will include consideration of climate change and its impacts, planning decisions, particularly large infrastructure projects, or, you know, one example, it could be Donald Trump's application to build a 13-foot high wall to protect his luxury golf course in County Clare. And one of the application forms was to protect it from increasingly volatile storms and rising sea levels, whilst, you know, he doesn't believe in climate change. Professional negligence claims against engineers, architects, surveyors, contractual disputes when supply chains break down. We've also got breach of fiduciary duty by pension trustees for their failure to take into consideration the material financial risk of climate change and what this poses, because they have a duty not only to all beneficiaries, not only the ones that are receiving their pensions now, but future beneficiaries that may be affected by losses arising from their decisions on investment. They're going to be shareholder actions against companies who have failed to plan for transition risks to their business and actually report the risk to shareholders. Competition law, particularly from greenwashing. Defamation claims by climate scientists who are being attacked and bringing allegations. Then we have slap suits by various organisations. These are strategic litigation against public participation. So people, for instance, there was a defamation action brought against Greenpeace in Canada for articles it had published. And then there's anti-regulatory actions by fossil fuel and other incumbents to protect their dominant position. So again, there's a very large array of areas where climate change is going to be involved. And then we have the not-so-conventional. Particularly for people practicing in England and Wales, a lot of the litigation that we're seeing appears non-conventional because it doesn't fit as well into our thinking. One example is the recent case of a Peruvian farmer who brought a law action against RWE, and his claim against this German utility was for contributing to environmental damage in his hometown. He demanded €17,000 in compensation, to finance the safety measures taken against the threat posed to his home by the melting glacier. He alleged that RWE's carbon emissions were partly responsible for the threat. RWE rejected the claim, saying a single emitter could not be held accountable for global developments such as climate change. This particular challenge has, of course, been rejected, not of course, but has been rejected by the Essen District Court as partially inadmissible and unfounded, but the claimant is going to appeal, so we understand. We also have the New York Attorney Generals. They've been looking at various matters. One is an investigation into the Peabody disclosures on the impact of climate change on future business. As a result of this investigation, Peabody has entered into an assurance of discontinuance agreement, which governs its future disclosures in this regard. And the New York Attorney General has also commenced an investigation into Exxon for concealing relevant information on the impacts of climate change from investors and the public. So this was very specific to the New York Attorney General, who's brought this investigation under the Martin Act. So this evidence that this investigation may uncover, we don't know where that may lead us to. And in Europe, the main case so far has been the agenda case. The claimant in this agenda is the contraction of the words urgent and agenda. And it is an NGO, and there were also 886 individual claimants who brought this case. In the agenda case, the lawyers made a conscious decision to bring a tort law claim. So this is very different to the normal administrative type law claims that we would expect. And they also chose to bring a tort law claim against the government and not a fossil fuel major, and not a carbon major. So they used what would normally be a private law claim and framed it in such a way to bring it as an action against the government. They argued that the current levels of greenhouse gas emissions are unlawful because they lead to or threaten to lead to global warming of more than 2 degrees. And on that basis, to dangerous climate change with severe and even potentially catastrophic consequences. In their evidence, they relied on the IPCC report on climate change, which the Dutch government wasn't going to argue against. So this is accepted evidence, and it would be difficult for the Dutch government to argue against it. They had the benefit of a specific provision in the Constitution, Article 21, which would be quite difficult for a country like the UK that doesn't have a constitution. So in this, Article 21 says, it shall be the concern of the authorities to keep the country habitable and to protect and improve the environment. So this was what they framed as their duty of care. The court considered these three main questions in this case. And the conclusions they reached were, how severe is the problem, the scale of the alleged danger of climate change, and what emission reductions are needed to avert danger, whether the Dutch state had a legal obligation to our agenda to take further reduction measures in view of the alleged danger of climate change. If this was the case, would this be an appropriate matter to be decided in a courtroom, or are these matters of political decision-making? Are these matters for the judiciary to intervene in, or are they matters for the elected government and executive? The court acknowledged and accepted the IPCC's evidence on severity of the problem and the hazardous risk climate change poses. It also looked at the state's international commitments and interpreted the obligations in the light of these. And importantly, the court held that Dutch law has no complete separation of state authorities, in this case between the executive and the judicial authorities. According to the court, it is better to say that the distribution of authorities between these two bodies and the legislative authority as well is intended to achieve a balance between the state authorities. In this regard, no single authority has primacy over the others in a general sense, or in all circumstances. So this is quite an important difference when we would consider a claim in the UK, in our jurisdiction. As I've already mentioned, the order was that the Dutch state must limit the state's annual greenhouse gas emissions to 25% below 1990 levels by 2020. So, you know, it's a significant order that the court has made. And it's an order that, in our case, we have the Climate Change Act, so we have targets, etc., in the Climate Change Act. But the Dutch court has actually imposed such a target. The decision has been extremely controversial in the Netherlands, with many scholars questioning whether the court's decision is an impermissible usurpation of the legislative powers and whether it is consistent with EU law. The Dutch government has appealed the decision, seeking to reopen all legal issues. So under the Dutch system, they can reopen and re-argue the case. And as I understand it, they are arguing completely. So some of the points that they may have not taken issue with previously, they are now. But despite this, this decision has had a major impact on climate litigation more generally. It has inspired litigation in New Zealand, in Pakistan, in Belgium. So people are using this and using the arguments that have been developed in Agenda and trying to export them and consider them in their own jurisdictions and how they may apply. We also understand that this has been quite important because it, in the finding, because the Parliament, the Dutch Parliament, has actually been obliged to implement the court order. So even though the appeal is going through, it has raised the level of debate on climate change and what the government's duties are. It has actually ensured that changes are being considered, policies are being influenced by the order. So even if the appeal is successful, there is still a lot that has been achieved by having this judgment at a lower court. It has made, you know, significant positive impact on domestic climate policy and debate. There have also been cases on the public trust doctrine or the atmospheric trust doctrine, which Harry will refer to, so I won't cover those. So what can we learn from these cases generally? So that's my role at ClientEarth, is looking at these cases and seeing what can we learn from them and where can they, we can develop litigation of this sort, and what can we, and where can it will be the next claim. So generally, our rights-based challenges are more likely to succeed. We would use the international consensus on the scientific cause of climate change, the IPCC reports, especially if we're going to bring in a claim against a state. Fuse public law and private law arguments and be innovative about how we do that. And seek a remedy that is practical and deliverable. So these are points that we would want to sort of make sure, because we want to provide the court with a way of actually delivering a remedy. Because ultimately, if they can't deliver a remedy, it's of no value. What do we expect on the international stage in the next 12 months? I think increasing, not that I have a crystal ball at all, but I think we will see increasing resort to the courts to fill the gap where the international community and governments fail to act, and especially if there are changes and drawbacks of policy, I can see that people will be challenging them a lot more. As to the science of climate attribution, this is becoming more readily understood by lawyers. This is becoming more settled, and then lawyers will want to rely on such evidence to push the courts further than their findings and the consensus of the IPCC. And one case which is only, we've only just got the English translation, but this is a case that you may want to consider, is the Austrian Federal Administrative Court have just reached a decision. Well, they haven't just reached the decision, we've just got the translation from German. where they blocked the third runway of the Vienna airport using considerations of climate change and part of their balancing in reaching that decision. So it would be worth looking at, because that is probably a pretty traditional, conventional form of challenge that was brought, but actually invited the court in this case to take consideration of the impacts of the third runway on climate change and other environmental issues. So that's certainly one that you might want to think about. But I think I'll just leave it there.
Thank you, Gillian. Are there any questions that are purely for clarification? Yes, Drew?
Yes, thanks.
Hi, Drew.
Hi. You mentioned that in the UK, bringing a case similar to your agenda is not going to work, given the dicta from the court and its order in your agenda regarding the relationship between the different governmental bodies.
Well, there are several reasons. Two main reasons. First, that we have the Climate Change Act. So Parliament has already determined what our position is. So, and in the UK, Parliament has supremacy. That was clearly shown in terms of the Article 50 Brexit. So if Parliament has already determined what our targets are, then that's what will stand. So the courts will only be able to interpret what the statutory provisions provide. They couldn't, like in the agenda case, seek to impose a duty on Parliament. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Fortunately, they are rather more stringent. The UK actually has, numerically speaking, quite ambitious targets at the moment.
Yeah.
I think it's 80% by 2050,
yeah.
Is that right? So 80% reduction by 2050.
And in fact, Agenda cited in their arguments, the claimants cited the UK as the best example of a climate change policy to have. So, but whether we're going to achieve that, that's a different thing.
Whether the Climate Change Act is going to stay in existence.
Exactly.
Okay, but we're getting into discussion. Let's not do this yet. Let's hold our discussion points for later. First, turn our attention to Harry. And you would you
yes,
like to
play
it?
Get the, well, I should turn the PowerPoint back on. I forgot what to say, but do we have something to move it forward, or do I need to be here to do that? So I guess I'll do it from here then. All right.
If you like mobility, I can take it from you.
No, it's fine. It doesn't matter. I should sit down and stand up. It's all good. Wonderful. So I want to start, I'm just grabbing the water from the table. I just wanted to start by saying a huge thank you to Joana Setzer for her organizing efforts and including me, and I also know your professor encouraged you to be here tonight as well. It's really just an honor and a pleasure to join this incredible group of people and to talk to you about this important issue. But knowing that there are a lot of students in the room, before I get to the substance of my remarks, I just wanted to say two things. The first thing is that it's really interesting to be talking to this sort of packed room of people about climate change litigation. The last couple weeks I've had various corporate law colleagues come up and say, hey, this seems like an interesting topic. And it makes me think about what it was like when I first started working on climate change litigation. So I ended up getting involved with these issues because I helped out on a petition that the Inuit brought over a decade ago, claiming that US climate policy under the Bush administration violated their human rights. In the process of working on that case, I became intrigued by the fact that there were all these lawsuits going on all over the world, not just in the United States at the time, but Germany and Nigeria, talking about climate change. And I started to wonder what the regulatory impact was. Nobody was talking about the regulatory impact. And so here I was a junior professor, pre-tenure, but really interested in this, started talking about this. And the second time I went and did a faculty workshop on one of my papers trying to think about the regulatory impact of climate change litigation a little over a decade ago. I had a senior person at that institution, I won't name the institution, you'll know why, say to me, now, in addition to telling me he was offended by my jargon, say to me, you know, why are you writing about climate change litigation? Don't you know that climate change is about trees? Now, people stop saying that to me over time. And of course, I've had the experience now of, you know, coming from someone from the United States during the Bush administration saying, yeah, I'm here to make you feel good about what you're doing on climate change. And then, you know, when I came during the Obama administration and sitting during the Paris negotiations and getting to see my country actually walk into applause to an international group on climate change, I never thought I'd see that because we had joined the High Ambition Coalition. And of course, it's not looking so good on our meeting our goals under the Paris Agreement right now in the United States under President Trump. But the point I want to say to the students in the room is this. Just, if you find something you think is interesting, stick to it, even if you get a bunch of people telling you, why are you talking about this? Because it may well become more interesting to them over time. The second thing I wanted to do is just, as Joana mentioned, I'm the incoming dean at Penn State Law in the School of International Affairs, which is, by the way, the only law school in the entire United States with an interlinked School of International Affairs. And also a president of the university who's a climatologist who's declared Penn State Energy University, by which he means that he's going to make it the number one energy university in the United States because he thinks these issues are so important. So as the incoming dean, I want to welcome all of you to our institution and reinforce that we really value our many international students at Penn State. It's the fourth most impacted university in the country, I think. The president has joined in with others opposing the executive orders. And in particular, the School of International Affairs consists of half international students. We have a huge LLM population. And so I feel like at this moment in time, as someone coming from my country, that I just want to say, we really welcome people from other countries to my country, and in particular, to the school at which I'm going to become the dean. All right. I'm speaking here, though, in my individual capacity. I in no way represent either the University of Minnesota or Penn State in my views on climate change. My remarks really build on the big picture that you just got from Gillian to talk about litigation globally. So what I want to do is sort of add to this picture that she just gave you on the emergence to draw from some of the work that I have done with Jackie Peel to think about the regulatory impact of climate change litigation and how we evaluate that over time. So at this point, we have 18 countries across six continents in which climate change litigation has been taking place. However, if you just read the news, you get a completely sort of inaccurate sense of what the vast majority of this litigation is, right? So, for example, I've had people come to me, and we'll talk about in a moment, the Juliana case in the United States, the public trust case. It is certainly an interesting, groundbreaking, important case. But the idea that it actually is where climate change litigation started in a country that has hundreds of cases, including three Supreme Court cases, is inaccurate, right? The vast majority of cases in all of the countries in which climate change litigation has taken place, and of course, my litigious country outstrips all others by a lot in terms of the number of cases, followed by Australia, which is part of why we've done comparative US-Australian work. But most of these cases are statutory cases involving what governments are doing. So either trying to push governments to do more or get them to do less. There are a number of emerging strands, though, of climate change litigation. Of course, ClientEarth has been one of the organizations at the forefront of this kind of work. So there's a whole strand. In fact, Jackie and I have an article that I toyed with presenting tomorrow on whether there's been a rights turn in climate change litigation. So there's a whole new strand of cases talking in rights terms. You were hearing about the agenda case. I won't repeat that. There's also an emerging area looking at using corporate and financial law in a variety of creative ways. And the other thing that I want to highlight is that while most cases deal with mitigation, adaptation cases have increasingly begun to emerge as well. Australia's really been the country in which adaptation litigation first
grew. The U.S. has had a handful of cases. Of course, the Pakistani rights case is an adaptation case as well. So I think it's important to remember that adaptation is a piece of this litigation conversation as well. So strategic litigation, as we were just hearing about, is really about using law to try to create social change. And I can tell you, as someone who is an impact, who did civil rights impact litigation in the United States before I was an academic, this is actually a little bit complicated. And part of what makes it a little bit complicated is because, as a lawyer, right, your duty is to your client and to zealously advocating on behalf of your client. But when you're doing impact litigation, you're also trying to change society in a broader way than just your individual clients. And so you're constantly navigating between those roles, and how that gets framed up is different in each jurisdiction. So how that looks in Europe is very different than how that looks in the United States. But what Jackie and I have done, and this is in the book that we wrote with Cambridge and some of our other work, is really try to come up with a model for understanding the regulatory impact of this litigation. Now, when you want to talk about impact, we think it's important that you think about both the direct and the indirect impacts. Well, what do I mean by that? Well, there are cases that have had extremely high direct impacts. Probably the case in the world that is the best example of this is the case that Gillian already mentioned, Massachusetts v. EPA, right? This first US Supreme Court case. Because this case really became the basis for the Obama administration's executive order that the Trump administration is in the process of dismantling. But that case very sort of clearly led to very particular regulatory impacts, right? And so when you look at those pathways, we've looked at the very limited constitutional interpretation human rights pathways, the ways in which statutory interpretation lead to sort of both substantive and procedural regulatory impacts, and then efforts that have been largely unsuccessful to date, though, you know, there's now this Juliana case in the pipeline in the United States, to use common law methods in common law countries to achieve these things. But I think if you stop the story there, you miss a lot of the impact of climate change litigation. And the way that I first began to think of this was actually back when I was involved with the Inuit petition, and there was this very interesting interview with Sheila Watt-Cloutier, who was then chair of the Inuit Circumpolar Conference, where she said, you know, this case may have little formal chance of success, of impact, but I view it as a way of beginning a human rights conversation with the United States. Right, and the Inuit case, though it was formally unsuccessful, got an enormous amount of press. The Juliana case, whatever happens with it, has got an enormous amount of press. The Urganda case, regardless of what happens on appeal, has gotten this enormous amount of press, as did Massachusetts v. EPA, which some have referred to as the most important environmental case in U.S. history. And so what we did, and we did a lot of interviews to try to get at this, was to try to understand the indirect effects, which we see as particularly about increasing costs and risks around climate change, and also about changing social norms and values, and have looked at how corporations, individuals, and governments respond to this litigation, and how their behavior is influenced by it. Now, as Gillian talked about, litigation can be both promotive and anti-regulatory. So I think that there's sometimes been an inclination, especially because, you know, this litigation first really emerged on the scene in the 90s, but really started to come of age in the first decade of this century. And when that was first coming of age, of course, you know, that was at a time when we had a U.S. president who was anti-regulatory. And so the cases that were the most high profile in the United States, of course, I don't mean to be U.S.-centric, it's just we've had so much of the litigation there, right? But a lot of it were challenges to try to get him to do stuff. And so I think there's a tendency sometimes, because the advocacy community is involved in this kind of litigation, to think of it all that way. But as she talked about, and as I'll sort of flag for you, a lot of it's been there's been a lot of anti-regulatory litigation as well. And what you particularly see in terms of anti-regulatory effects of litigation are twofold. One is you tend to see a lot of anti-regulatory litigation when there's really progressive regulation. So for example, in the United States, when the Obama administration was doing a lot on climate change, there were a lot of legal challenges to what he was doing. But the second way, and that also is happening in states in the United States and still is, that are particularly progressive. But the second way is you can sometimes get backlash even after promotive decisions. So one of the things we saw in Australia, for example, when we looked at impacts, is that you'd sometimes get a positive outcome, but then you'd actually get negative legislative change afterwards in response to the positive outcome. So I think it's important to say, on the one hand, when we did our sort of comprehensive look, we found that the overall impact of litigation was promotive. So overall, climate litigation thus far has helped advance climate change regulation and not block it. But I think it's important not to minimize that litigation is not all about getting people to regulate more. So I have some slides to tell you a little bit about the United States and Australia, and then I have one on Europe that I figured I'd mostly skip based on who was presenting ahead of me, which I will. But I just wanted to give you a sense of where both the United States litigation, because it is the sort of biggest set of litigation in the world, has been, and where I think it may go under the Trump administration. So the vast majority, the most important, sort of most significant case in U.S. litigation is the Massachusetts VPA case. And the Massachusetts VPA case has really interesting implications right now for the Trump administration for the following reason. A lot of times when people in jurisdictions, other jurisdictions, talk about Massachusetts VPA, they don't get the holding precisely enough. And it's actually the precision of this holding that's important to why this is an issue potentially for Trump. Because the EPA the Supreme Court didn't tell the EPA it had to regulate. What the Supreme Court told the EPA is either regulate or justify better why you're not regulating. And so that was why the Obama administration then did this endangerment finding, right, and found that there was danger and then did regulation based on that. So a key question right now for the Trump administration is, if he dismantles the various regulation that the Obama administration did pursuant to Massachusetts VPA, there's still a Supreme Court decision there, and there's still 5 votes on that case. So then the question becomes, even with a justice missing, there's 5 votes on that case. And so then the question becomes, how is he complying with Mass VPA and what might happen? The vast majority of cases, though, are these not very well-publicized cases, challenges around coal-fired power plants. Those have had a really significant impact together with the market shifts that have happened around coal. And there's also been, as I said, these emerging adaptation cases that are really interesting and that we can get into in more depth in Q&A, because I know I'm only supposed to go 20 minutes right now. But I actually find them really fascinating. As the problem gets worse, they often come up in sort of local context, in coastal context, and all sorts of interesting ways. As Gillian mentioned, the nuisance pathway in the United States has not been successful to date, in part because of the Supreme Court decision in AEP versus Connecticut. But this also potentially changes under the Trump administration, depending on what our Congress does. What do I mean by that? Well, this is more improbable than a case about Massachusetts VPA lack of compliance. So the AEP versus Connecticut decision said, look, we won't let you do nuisance as an alternative pathway. It's displaced because the EPA has authority to regulate under the Clean Air Act. So that always left a door open, that if the EPA's authority to regulate under the Clean Air Act ever gets taken away, that pathway potentially reopens. Now, I don't think Congress is going to bother to do that, because we currently have a head of the EPA who doesn't believe in climate change and is sort of dismantling regulation. So I don't know why you bother to get rid of that authority under the Clean Air Act in the United States right now. But if our Congress got in its head and did that, this potentially reopens that litigation pathway. The case that's been getting the most attention out of the United States right now, of course, is the Juliana case, which is an incredibly compelling case. It's really unclear what is going to happen with that case. It's having huge indirect impacts. As a direct matter, though, it has survived a motion to dismiss. But for those of you unfamiliar with US law, a motion to dismiss is under a highly deferential standard of review, which says you assume the facts to be true. So it's yet to be seen what's going to happen with this case on the merits. So it's early days still in this case, even though it's getting a ton of public attention. And I think has, you know, if it's successful, has the potential to have a huge impact. So I don't want to understate in any way both, you know, the excitement being generated around this case, the novel claims under this case, and the fact that the public trust doctrine is a pathway that I think has some real potential legs in common law jurisdiction. But it, just to say, it's early days in that case. The second thing to say about that case is that, for those of you, again, unfamiliar with U.S. law, it has a very unusual framing in that it puts public trust together with substantive due process. This was an area of law that I really didn't fully understand until I taught civil rights law in China, because you get into these weird things about like penumbras, these emanations of the U.S. Constitution. It's a part of our Constitution that gets used, for example, in privacy cases. Basically, what happened under U.S. constitutional law is we got rid of the viability of using the Privileges and Immunities Clause very effectively to bring rights claims. And so some lawyers creatively used due process to say due process isn't just about procedure, but has a substantive dimension to protect rights. And so that's been used in a lot of privacy and abortion cases in the United States, and that's what they're using in the Giuliana case. So it's a very interesting legal framing in that case as well. In the anti-regulatory front, there have been dormant commerce challenges, dormant commerce clause challenges. So this has been sort of pushes against states in terms of whether their energy and climate regulation violated interstate commerce. Two of these cases have been unsuccessful, one has been successful. There's also in the common law space, and as a property professor, I find this case to be tremendously interesting, even though I don't have time to go into depth about it, but there's a takings case in which a court in New Jersey found that this effort to build dunes, that when you compensate someone for taking their property in this context, you take into account not just the value of the property taken, but also the positive impact it had on them. And so it ends up giving an award of $1. It's a very interesting case. We can talk about it in a few minutes. All right. Then Australia, I'm not going to go into any depth in because I'm almost out of time, but I just want to highlight they're the jurisdiction that's had the second most cases. And I figured it would be useful to get a comparative context out of me since I knew you would do a great job with the European context. But just to note that a lot of their mitigation cases have focused on coal-fired power and coal mines, and then they've really been the leading jurisdiction for adaptation cases, in part because Australia hit climate change impacts more severely than other developed countries more quickly. A lot of those cases have been coastal cases. The other thing that's very interesting in the Australian context that I should note is that all these U.S. cases I've been talking about are happening in courts of general jurisdiction, right? Whereas a lot of the Australian cases happen in their environmental and land use courts, so specialized courts that know these issues. And that's really impacted the flow of litigation in Australia. As I told you, you've already hit Europe enough, so I won't go into depth into the emerging litigation in Europe, but simply say about it that part of what's so interesting about what's going on in Europe right now and the groundbreaking work that ClientEarth and others are doing here in Europe is that I think a part of that project has also been that Europe has less of an impact litigation tradition, in part because a lot of its countries are civil law countries, right, where impact litigation is more of a common law phenomenon in sort of its birthplace. But also, for a variety of reasons, right, there's been less of that tradition, and so one of the things that's been really exciting to watch is with ClientEarth and others really sort of bringing that kind of approach here and kind of moving it forward in a variety of different ways. I
I'm about to close because I know we're about out of time, but I just want to say that one of the things that Jack and I were talking about, and there's too much light on this, you can't actually see what's behind the slides, is thinking about, so here's the question, right? When you want to make social change work, right? And I would guess that many of the students in this room, your focus in your career, you want to make the world a better place, right? I decided back in my 20s that I only had two career goals, to make the world a little better than I found it and do work that felt meaningful. And every job I've had, that's the gut check that I put it against. And so the question is, how do you make sure that what you do is actually having an impact? And so part of what Jackie and I have been thinking about is that question. How do you trace a pathway from the strategies you come up with, the cases that you bring, the outcomes of those cases, to sort of the big picture goals about climate change? And how do you get to those? And I think that this process of thinking is useful not just in the climate context, but others, because I think one of the things that sometimes happens in social change work, certainly I've been involved in a lot of it in a number of different substantive contexts over the years, is that sometimes people get really opportunistic, right? So there's some moment and people respond to the moment. And don't get me wrong, it's important to respond to moments, and moments are powerful, and sometimes you can converge around a moment. But I also think it's important, if you're really gonna make change over time, if you really wanna make transformative change, if you wanna make the incremental change turn into the transformative change, to think about how you get from A to B, and to really think about how what you're doing fits into an overall strategy. So, how effective is climate change as a mitigation adaptation? Oh, this is where my not totally updated slide came through. So, here's what we found, right? There have really been a lot of impacts from this litigation in this first, couple of decades of it, and really, you know, it's really the drumbeat's increased in the last decade. Most of it's actually incremental, not transformative. So most of it's not the cases you hear about in the news, but rather the cumulative effect of small victories adding together and changing an environment. But there have been these breakthrough cases that we've been hearing about today, like Massachusetts EPA and Urgenda. The other thing, as I've said, is that we found that the anti-regulatory litigation often can serve as a significant break on regulation. And so it's important in this space to really think about the role that it's playing. Also, the indirect effects can be at least as important as the direct effects. And so that's part of why the media work that surrounds this litigation and other work is so important. And finally, that litigation is a tool. It's not the tool. So when you're doing a social change campaign around climate change, the real question is, how does litigation fit into your overall strategic picture, rather than it being sort of the only thing you're thinking about? And that fits more broadly in work that both Jackie and I have done, thinking about polycentric governance. So coming back to where I began, and that person who said to me, why are you writing about litigation? Don't you know that it's about treaties? He was wrong, of course, but the treaties matter too, you know? And so what I would say is that when you start to think about the big picture of what matters in climate change, right? It's about the treaties, it's about the networks of subnational governments, it's about the corporations who are showing leadership and the corporations who aren't showing leadership. It's about all these different kinds of actors and about law at all different levels, from the international all the way down to the very local. And all of these are pieces of the puzzle of how we do or don't make a difference in solving this problem that poses such a great challenge for this generation and for our planet. And so when we think about litigation and its impact, we need to think about how it fits into that puzzle and how it can be most effective in advancing these goals. Thank you.
Thank you both very much. Oh, I thought so many questions I would like to ask, but you know what, I am few and you are many, and so I'll open up immediately and give you the opportunity to ask questions. I know you're going to ask.
Sam is the person who walks up at that moment and fills that space so that other people that'll come stand up. Come on, don't be shy. Yeah, there you go.
There we go, there we go. All right, let's come back.
Yeah, hi there. I'm Hannah from the Grantham Institute. And I wanted to ask you, what do we still need to find out in order to advance our understanding of this, in order to make this a more useful thing in an academic and policy orientation context?
What do we still need to find out about litigation, about climate science, about...
About litigation in the context of the polycentric governance, about litigation in the context of addressing climate change. You've done an immense amount of work, and colleagues have followed, and I'm trying to understand what kind of work we still need to do.
What further research would be helpful? What would help here? Like, Gillian probably also would...
Yeah, you also probably use on what's
what
needed.
What would help you in what kind of research would be helpful for you in making your cases?
Yep. In making our cases, well...
And then I'll add.
Yes, one that's quite interesting for us is corporate identity and how we can aggregate the responsibilities of various corporations or subsidiaries of corporations. And their responsibilities for their emissions. So otherwise we struggle with sort of de minimis levels of emissions or contributions to emissions. So that's one area that we're interested in reviewing. We also work on the science as well, with the Oxford Martin School on attribution climate attribution science. And that is really to develop discussion and dialogue between lawyers and scientists, because the science is not readily understood by lawyers. We say the same words, but we mean different things. So we're trying to narrow those differences and help explain to lawyers how they can use this science in bringing legal proceedings. So that's a couple.
So mine really build off of Gillian. So I would say three main areas. So the first is I actually do want to start with the science too. I agree with what she said, and I want to add to it, which is that, one of the peculiarities of my own academic career is I did a geography PhD on the side. I'm actually a big fan of PhDs on the side. They're a little less stressful. So I started as an assistant professor at Oregon. I defended my dissertation a week after getting a full professor at Minnesota. And the great thing about geography is, of course, that it brings together the hard science and the social science. There are a lot of climatologist geographers. And there's been some really good work by climatologists on sort of a lot of these nuances of scale. And there's one in particular that I think is crucial for there to be more scientific research on to support litigation. And it's gotten better. We've had progress in the last decade, but it's the following. When you're at large scales, when you're at large spatial and temporal scales, that's where you have the highest level of certainty in climate change science. Where you get greater levels of uncertainty is where you scale down. And this goes to these attribution questions that Jillian's talking about. When you want to say that this particular set of emissions in this particular place at this particular point in time causes the harm, which from a legal perspective, from a litigation perspective, is really crucial to be able to do. It's not just that that's harder to do, it's harder science, it's that that's not where the research had focused. And so there's been a real shift in the last decade to trying to fill in that smaller scale research in the climate science arena, and it's improved. But for those of you who have a scientific bent or want to partner with scientists, that strikes me as an area crucial to litigation where research needs to continue. We need to continue to have more research on the smaller scale pieces. Mm-hmm. The second thing is, I think that research is needed into some of these innovative and emerging legal strategies, right? So one of the things that I saw, part of how I got involved in the Inuit petition before I was working on climate change litigation, I was very involved in environmental rights and international environmental rights and the domestic analog in the United States, environmental justice. And what I saw was a destruction of a whole jurisprudence of environmental rights brought by lawyers who really didn't have a sophisticated understanding, or maybe they did, but the way they brought the case didn't make a lot of sense, and they got bad precedent, and it sort of wiped out a lot of cases. So I won't speak to what they knew, but the way they brought the case didn't make a lot of sense strategically. Similarly, I was practicing as a civil rights lawyer when one of the most devastating decisions in civil rights law came down, the Sandoval case, which again, it's outside of climate, so you may or may not know it, it's US law, but basically taking away a private right of action to bring disparate impact litigation. And so what I would say is that at a very concrete level, the more that people can do research into how innovative causes of action can be brought in a way that's legally sound and likely to succeed in courts. There's a whole conversation about whether it's worth bringing things that you have no chance of winning, and I know people have different views on this. But it's also very clear that it's wins that have helped advance the ball on this. And so sort of helping support those people on the front lines by doing that kind of nuanced research, I think, is really important. And then the third thing I would say is then there's that big picture conceptual stuff. So I actually think the slide before this slide, where we're talking about evaluation, et cetera, I actually think that is hard and under-researched. So I think it's easy to sit and crunch the cases numerically, but to really understand what they are and how they're interacting with society is an area that I think there's still more research needed in order to really understand their impact and to help them have a greater impact.
And can I add one more? One thing that sort of we struggle with as well is, you know, the understanding of the social utility of fossil fuels and the understanding that if you are going to bring a claim, what are the responsibilities of these, fossil fuel companies? And are they stages where they should have, we can hold them responsible for their lack of action? So is there any sort of policy considerations around that in terms of showing what they could have done and what they didn't do?
Okay, thank you. Yes, all right, we have another question over there.
I read an article about this court case where 21 children are suing the US government over the idea that they have the right to live in a livable atmosphere. So how far do you think this is going to go? And also, do you think this would be, so this is more a London case, but do you think this would be applicable in the case of London where there is a problem with the air quality and there has been studies showing that a lot of diseases linked to poor air quality. Do you think that this case could be taken to court in the UK as well in a similar way?
So perhaps I'll talk about the US side and you can talk about the UK side since you guys have done a lot of work in that space. So in the US side, that is the Juliana case I was talking about before. So this is a case that, as I said, is framed around two primary legal theories. One is using something called the public trust doctrine, which is it's a very interesting doctrine in common law countries. And it's actually different in each place. So in the United States, every state has a different public trust doctrine. But public trust is the idea that there's a responsibility, there's sort of a duty that states have in these common resources. So it's partly based in that. And then, as I said, it's partly in this very unusual constitutional argument, bringing a set of substantive due process claims. So far, it has gone through it's passed important hurdles, but it's gone through ones that are in a very deferential standard of review. And so it's really unclear what will happen when it reaches the merits. I think whatever happens with the case, it provides a high level of indirect effects, because I think the particular framing of it and the way in which it's been interacting with US politics by replacing President Obama with President Trump, that helps bring public attention to these issues and to sort of the human impacts of these issues. So I think regardless of what happens with it legally, and I would say it's very uncertain when it gets to the merits what's going to happen, it's already had an impact through raising public awareness.
And they are making a documentary to go alongside it, so the documentary is going through the process as the case progresses and interviews them. So no matter what happens in the case, there will be a sort of record which then can sort of develop that. In terms of clean air, the position is that We've got the EU directive, and the challenges have been brought under that. So it's unlikely, we don't think a Juliana type case would be able to be brought, and it wouldn't actually achieve anything more than what has already we've already done in our two court cases that we've brought, both up to the Supreme Court and to the High Court, where the courts have ordered the UK government to, you know, revise and amend their plans to take into account their legal obligations under the Ambient Air Quality Directive.
I actually just want to add on one more thing, which is it goes to the first question about translational research. So one of the things that I think is really exciting to do as an academic is to think about things and then figure out how to implement them. So that's one of the things I'm doing in the local government space right now as well. But this is a great example of translational research because before Jackie and I wrote our book together, I have an edited book on climate change with Will Burns, in which we solicited a chapter from my former colleague Mary Wood at Oregon. She's an expert on public trust and been doing a lot of thinking about public trust and climate change. And so she wrote a chapter in that book and some other articles thinking about how public trust could be used in climate litigation. And so it was that kind of academic research around public trust that helped to undergird some of the efforts that the advocacy groups were making. And so that when I was talking about that second category, and this is a good example of that, where helping sort of explore what those pathways could look like. And you can do it in a variety of ways. I've also taught classes, for example, on climate change litigation with first the Western Environmental Law Center and then the Southern Environmental Law Center's clients, where we help them think about how to bring climate change claims into the more general environmental claims that they bring. So I think there's a variety of ways you can do it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to take next question. We don't have that much time left, so if you can be succinct in your questions
and answers.
And answers, that would be appreciated.
I'll try
to realize something. Behind Delphine, you had
so I wonder if you could say something. You talked about a number of different factors. So we've got constitutions, legal cultures, kind of state structures, federalism. So I wonder if you could say something about the sort of factors that might be shaping the opportunities and direction of climate change across different jurisdictions.
Do you want me first or you want me to?
You go first.
All right. So I think one of the most crucial differences between jurisdictions is whether they're common or civil law jurisdictions relevant to litigation. Litigation in civil law countries simply looks different than litigation in common law countries. So I think that's probably as you're looking across jurisdictions. I think the second question is what kind of legal tradition you have around litigation in that country, and so how much of a culture shift is required in order to jumpstart it. The third factor that I think ends up being really important, as I talked about, is what kind of courts hear it. And sort of how you might frame it based on whether you're going to general jurisdictional versus land use courts. The fourth thing is where as you research what kinds of claims might be able to be brought, there are just differences in underlying statutory law that really matter. So why has Australia not had a Massachusetts VPA? Because its national environmental laws don't have the same kinds of citizen suit provisions in the way that the US ones do that made them particularly amenable to those kinds of claims. So those are just a few of the different ways. And I think if one thinks about a global strategy, I think it's about having people in the jurisdictions who have jurisdictional expertise and understand the law and those factors play a key role in guiding it, and then people who've seen what's going on globally and across jurisdictions be able to interact with that, and then there be mutual learning between jurisdictions.
And that, to a certain extent, is how, say, the agenda is exported. So you have this one case that's successful, and then it can be taken into other jurisdictions. For instance, you go from a EU jurisdiction into Pakistan or somewhere else where they make it their own and look at it individually. And I think culturally, the culture difference is really important. And that's one of the issues that we have, is that our judges are extremely conservative, and they, especially with the common law, they do want to see things evolve slowly and carefully. They won't make big leaps. and they're not necessarily ambitious. They don't like to look at, you know, be, they don't want to be brave. So, and our appeal systems. But culturally, I think that is, the culture of the judiciary is really important.
All right, that's a question. Yeah, questions.
In India's context, the carbon is not treated as pollutant in its national ambient air quality standard program that is there. So what is the scope of litigation? Because judges have always interpreted that it involves right to life and right to livelihood. It is always either the environmentalism of the poor, or once it is linked to right to life, then judiciary comes into picture and it intervenes and corrects the situations. So there is no litigation till now on this, relating to carbon or reducing greenhouse gases. So what is the scope, what impact this litigation can have on India's?
So the opportunity, are there still opportunities for successful litigation in countries where carbon is not recognized as a pollutant?
Yes.
Well, speaking as someone who I guess comes from a country where I guess carbon is still technically viewed as a pollutant, but there's some other views on that in my country. I think that, so first of all, one of the strands of research that I haven't been talking about today that Jack and I have been doing has been on energy partisanship and how you make progress in a partisan environment. And one of the things that I've found in my bipartisan work in the United States is that I don't really care what words you use as long as you're actually doing mitigation and adaptation. So sometimes, you don't use the word climate change, but you're still doing energy efficiency and you're still advancing mitigation, right? Or you don't use climate change, you talk about disaster relief, but it's really about adaptation or preparing for disaster. So I guess what I would say, first of all, is I don't think it matters so much if it uses the words climate change or not, as long as it gets at climate change. The second thing is, I'm not an Indian jurisdictional expert at all. You probably are much more of one, but my sense is that India is a strong public interest litigation tradition, in some ways stronger than any of these countries we've been talking about. And so I think that there's a lot of scope, and I know a number of Indian lawyers have been thinking about this, within that public interest tradition to bring these kinds of cases. And that's where, again, I think not fussing about the words too much is crucial. So if the word climate change doesn't get you there, fine, use different words.
Especially in relation to adaptation.
Yeah.
That's where you could focus your efforts on meeting the challenges of climate change.
Should we maybe take all the questions?
Yeah. Okay, let's take the three questions together and then.
Okay, I'll be really quick. So I've got a particular question in climate change communication. And has there been any efforts? I'm sure some of you guys are familiar with Naomi Oreska's book, Merchants of Doubt. Has there been any litigation focused on those elements, where you've got the fossil fuel companies actually putting large amounts of money into misinforming the public? And is there anything going on in the litigation space around that, and also with the right-wing so-called think tanks?
Okay, so legal responsibility for climate change denial actions. Yes.
I've become interested in human rights approaches to corporate accountability for climate change, and I came across the Philippines case where the Human Rights Commission is currently inquiring. Investigating the relationship between corporate greenhouse gas emissions and human rights violations resulting from climate change. And I was wondering whether you think the particular case in the Philippines could have any contribution to holding corporations accountable via climate litigation.
Okay, the likelihood of success of using human rights language basically vis-a-vis private actors, vis-a-vis corporations.
And then thirdly, yes?
Yes, I think by and large, up to now, you've been talking about actions within certain jurisdictions, and I wondered if you could comment on the sort of implications for international law and actions between jurisdictions.
Okay, fantastic. Beautifully succinct, thank you very much. Gillian, is there...
I'll start with the Philippines case. This is an investigation, and I think it's important. I think it's a interesting approach to go to somewhere where legal liability isn't going to be determined. It's something that I think it's the first time where it gives the fossil fuel companies, the carbon majors who have been named, the opportunity to put their arguments and have them considered. And we've actually put in an amicus brief into that. So, and in that we sort of set out all the reasons why the commission has the ability to, because the carbon majors approach was, well, you don't have the ability to deal with this, and there's one, I think, one of them that actually engaged effectively. So, but I think it's a stepping stone. I think it could be, if the commission accepts its role, could be quite important.
Mm-hmm. So the answer is yes, there is litigation framed around that. It's particularly come up in the context of Exxon, of course, where there's been a lot of public attention around its denials. It comes up in other ways too, though, that are less direct, which is in there's an emerging set of issues, not necessarily litigation per se, but around some of it's litigation, but not all of it, around disclosure of climate risks and companies have obligations to disclose those risks. So there's both the actual misinformation kinds of stuff, but also these questions of sort of companies really having to accurately portray climate risks and some of the corporate, and that's part of the corporate and financial law stuff that's been emerging. In terms of straight international law, it's hard, and here's why. The International Court of Justice, the United States, of course, does not, after the Nicaragua case, no longer sort of accepts compulsory jurisdiction. So you'd have to get it under a treaty. Hard to do. You can certainly get it other countries conceivably, but this country-to-country thing, right? So there's been a long sort of, for example, some discussion of whether small island states could bring some sort of an action in the ICJ or particularly impacted countries. Possible it'll happen. But I think one of the big problems is that the biggest developed country major emitter, it's hard to get at through that particular forum. There have been, climate has come up in the WTO context, and I think will increasingly, in part in some of the kind of trade and environment disputes. So I think that's an emerging area. There are people who have done some really interesting work looking at international financial instruments. David Hunter did a chapter in that original book we did on that together. I forget who we did it with. I should know this. But in any case, so there have been some thinking about how to use those mechanisms. And of course, the other two types that have actually been used in petition, so there has been an effort to use regional human rights law. Of course, that has not succeeded to date in any sort of a sort of meaningful way that could be binding, but it's conceivable as these rights cases continue to build. I think the jurisdiction that's most likely to be able to have teeth around this is actually in Europe, the European Court of Human Rights, which has a particularly strong set of mechanisms and a strong tradition of environmental rights. We had thought the Inter-American Commission, which has a strong environmental rights tradition, would be a good forum, but the Inuit petition did not succeed. I think that there may be openness in other forums. The question would be what kind of enforceability come out of those regional forums, like the African one. And then the final place that it's been attempted is, of course, in the World Heritage space. So there were these petitions brought to the World Heritage Commission around danger listing. And they did a whole study and said things could be danger list, but then didn't danger list any of those things. I think that part of what's going on, honestly, in some of the World Heritage and human rights context, is that the way these mechanisms normally operate is very localized. So you have air pollution hurting the Taj Mahal and you need to do something about the air pollution. Whereas the problem with climate change is it's not like you can have the country that's being impacted come up with a strategy for solving it on its own. You'd have to bring in other countries. And so what it would look like to use those mechanisms looks very different than the way they're typically used right now. I think that was part of why the reticence there. So I think one of the questions in the international law space, and I could keep going, there are other things like fisheries, et cetera, that could come into play with climate change because it's so cross-cutting. But other than the WTO context, I think there's not a whole lot of things that I see massively on the horizon in international tribunals.
No, I agree. And although I think in the terms of the financial, and that's when it can be brought.
Yeah, I agree.
And it's done in a specific way over those agreements and in arbitration arrangements. And I don't know if it's still online, but Philippe Sands did a talk, reviewed the ability to bring such a claim, and he gave a lecture at the Supreme Court a couple of years ago, and that it'd be a good background to have a look at that.
Well, and in raising arbitration, I mean, a huge piece of arbitrations going on globally right now are energy arbitrations,
yeah.
And I think that climate issues may increasingly come into those arbitrations over time.
Okay, well, thank you very much. That concludes our session for this evening. Thank you all for your insightful questions and for your attention, and of course also for your attendance. And of course, great thanks to both our excellent speakers, Gillian and Harry. We very much enjoyed it. I hope that you will come away from this session inspired and encouraged to go and look anew at the different kind of roles that courts can play and the different ways in which we can try and mount some responses to these massive